I am Shusara Kona Kumara. Welcome to Satsang. You are beginningless. You are endless. You are divine. Good evening, everyone. This is Shusara Kona Kumara. You're listening to Satsang with the Shambhala Center. We are so thrilled to have you back with us tonight, and we're going to go ahead and get things started. So go ahead, take a nice deep breath. We'll clear the space. Mother, Father, God that I am, through the great central sun hierarchy, through the office of the Christ, through the order of Melchizedek, I call upon Archangel Michael to bring the sapphire blue ray. Cut away, cut away, cut away anything in all of our four lower vehicles not emanating directly from our I am presence. I now call on Archangel Zachiel, keeper of the violet flame. Blaze, blaze, blaze the violet flame through all of our four lower bodies. Transmute, transmute, transmute all the psychic debris Michael has cut free. I now bring forth the invincible ring pass knot and the mirror blue light of invisibility to completely surround each of us. And I call forth a shaft of pure Christ light, one to surround each of us, and I ask that they be brought to the center of the earth, where I call on Archangel Gabriel to seal them, and I ask that the legions of Michael completely surround each tube of light. And now I ask that our vibrations be raised high above the psychic and astral worlds to the highest realm of illumined truth we each can attain at this time. And now, Mother, Father, God, we place ourselves in service to you and to humanity, and the Shambhala Center Core Council places itself in service to you and to all those listening. We ask that only that which is direct from you be permitted into our perceptions and that all else of the lower mind be kept out. And we ask that only that which is direct from you be permitted through us. Because we have asked this, we consider it so. So be it. To stay where you are. Let's just do a little exercise. Sunday is the winter solstice. It's also a Capricorn new moon. It's a rather momentous day. We're already feeling the incoming energies. So let's just take a minute to open ourselves up to these energies as they continue to ramp up going into the solstice and then start to taper off coming out of it for a few days. Why don't you each make the internal intention to be as open a vessel as possible for the incoming light, that you may receive it and actualize it, ground it into this reality, and that you may walk in that light moving forward. Take a nice deep breath, set that intention. I want you to visualize that light coming into your crown, filling the four lower bodies. And now that crystalline white light is emanating out in all directions from the core of your being. One more deep breath. Beautiful. Very well done. All right, come on back. So tonight we have Megan and Tim and PLAN with us. We'll be hearing from them during the course of the hour, I'm sure. So Sunday, I think we need to start with an announcement. I said last week that we were going to have our radio station up and running for you so that if you wanted to join us in meditation for the solstice, you'd be able to do that. And Tim, our IT man extraordinaire, has made that possible for us. So if you go to theshambhalacenter.org, and Shambhala, of course, spelled S-H-A-M-B-H-A-L-A. If you go to theshambhalacenter.org, you will see a link that says media, and you click on the media link, and you will see, is there another link for the radio? Okay, so there's a link for the radio, and click on that. What we're going to do is set it up so that beginning on Sunday, 12:01 a.m., the 2-hour meditation that we're going to have ready is going to start playing, and it's just going to repeat all day long for 24 hours. So if you want to tune in with us at the same time that the Shambhala Center is in meditation, we will be in meditation from 12 noon until 2 Eastern time. And what time is the actual new moon? It's like 6 in the evening, or PLAN, do you know? She lost her mic.
I think Tim said that it was at 4 something, right?
Okay, so Google somewhere it. 4 to 6 p.m. in there. You can Google it and find out.
I'll Google it right now.
Okay. Anyway, that's when the actual solstice hits, so a lot of people like to be in meditation at that time. Also, I would do the same for the new moon, whenever the actual new moon, the specific time for that. That's if for people who do follow astrology, a new moon is the perfect time to get something, new ventures, new things that you want to happen, or the things that you are desiring to have happen moving forward in the next 12-month cycle. That's the time to really set the intention. And with it coupling with the winter solstice, it only happens every couple hundred years or so. So it is a really big deal. And it's part of the immense shifting that we are going to be seeing in the next year here. And this is going to kind of kick it off even before New Year's. So I would really recommend, whether you're not, you tune into our streaming meditation, please, you know, go into your own silent, quiet space and set your intentions and, you know, kind of just be a receiver of those energies, because they will be very powerful. So are you seeing it yet, darling?
A very confusing chart.
Okay, so I'll keep talking and then you can just cut in whenever you find it, okay? So just one more time, if you tend to tune in through the BBS station, I'm sure there's a link on our page on the BBS station to get to our website. But just in case you don't see it, it's theshambhalacenter.org. And once you get on there, you can either scroll down on the front page, or there are actually little, you know, like header links on the top of the page, and you can click on media. Yes, you found it?
6:03 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
6:03 p.m. Okay. So hopefully we'll have one that starts at 6. I don't know if that's going to work out with the 2-hour thing. So anyway. Okay, very good. Well, I guess I'll say a little bit before we do anything specific about what I started out the physical satsang session in Charlotte with today, which was concerning the solstice and the energies and what's happening in 2015. So, you know, when you're in this kind of space long enough, you just really get very attuned to what you see moving in the collective and how things seem to be setting themselves up. And you also receive inner guidance that's showing you where things are headed. So and anyone who knows me well enough will tell you, like, for this whole past year, I've been saying to our core council here that I could foresee very strongly that my work was going to be shifting, and that I couldn't see where it was headed or how it was going to look, but I really felt a shift coming, and I was experiencing a lot of difficulty because my personal life, I, as you know by now, if you listen often enough, you know, I'm a mother of three and I have a beautiful husband for the last 21 years now. And so my life is pretty busy. I also have a business. I make spiritual aromatherapy products when I'm not, you know, crazy busy doing everything else. And then, of course, I'm the founder of the Shambhala Center for Spiritual Awareness. And the interesting thing that I witnessed for myself this year was how the way I have functioned in the past was not going to work anymore. And that was a little disconcerting because my life is extremely busy. I'm sure just me saying what I kind of have to do just there points that out to you. So I couldn't quite figure out what to do with that. And I had, so for as many times as I kind of made the recommitment, I'm going to meditate more. Like, I mean it this time. I'm not going to stop to do all this other stuff. I know I need to be in meditation every day and all these things. Like, it just never worked out. And I had an opportunity this year to take a couple beautiful long trips away where I had the opportunity to just be by myself for 2 to 3 weeks. And it was incredible because the reconnection that I experienced in just being in my own space was extremely powerful. And it gave me a very strong sense in returning of how important it was that for my work moving forward, that I have my own space. So we're in the process of actually creating that close by in my own backyard so I can have a space to go to where I can do my meditation and be cut off from the children and cut off from all the activity that goes on in the house and just be in my own energy. So this is a good time for everyone to really take a look back at this past year and see what kind of impulses or inner guidance you've been getting that maybe you've been dismissing or saying to yourself, oh, that's not realistic. And to really take note now and commit to making it happen moving forward. There's a big shifting taking place this year. And as I was saying to the group before, and I don't want to say this in a way that would be, kind of fear-inducing in anybody because that's not my place. I'm not about fear. But I will say that in this work, regardless of the timing of it, in this work, you know, as you, not even outside of the work, just you as being a human being that's experiencing polarized consciousness, okay? It is your journey to actually walk out of that. Now, if that takes a bazillion years, it takes a bazillion years. But at some point, you actually will walk off the life-death cycle and your consciousness will be fully consciously aware of itself again in the illumined worlds, which you still reside in. You just aren't experiencing that consciously right now. When the body goes into deep sleep, that's where you are. But you wake up and you don't remember. Right. And you don't have those experiences unless you're given the grace of carrying some memory back with you. Just know that whether or not you're on a conscious spiritual path, you're in the process of doing this anyway. Everybody is. And at some point, what the seeker recognizes is that all of those things that they have carried with them lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, the same patterning that they've carried, the things that are part of the psyche that says that I'm not good enough and I've been bad, that I should be ashamed of myself, I'm unlovable, I'm unforgivable, all of these things are things that the collective believes about itself. And from a collective level, that's true. And from a personal level, that's true. Because the personal is representative of the collective and vice versa. Well, as those things sit there, what happens is the personal self, the ego, and lower mind, whatever we want to call it, is very dedicated to keeping itself in a space where it doesn't look at that. Okay. other than in rare cases with, you know, people who have chronic severe depression and who spend all their time in that space, most people actually swing out of that space so that they don't experience it. And what they end up doing is taking all these things that they feel terrible about, and they kind of stuff them back into the recesses of the subconscious. So they will be in denial over them. They'll repress them. And the thing is that on this planet, if you've been listening to me long enough, you understand that the planet is about balance, okay? We live in a polarized reality. That means that both extremes are represented here, the extreme that's on the positive side, the extreme that's on the negative. Well, it's a balancing act on the planet because they have to be held in balance. You see what I'm saying? I hope that that's understandable to everybody. The Buddha's instruction to walk the middle path is part of the teaching on how to walk off the life-death cycle, because if you are too far on either side, you are out of balance. And the point is to bring it back to this neutral place where you aren't attached to either side and you walk right through the center of it. When we hold things unconsciously, in a space where we are not willing to look at it, because of the way that this reality is set up, it has to come to you in a way that you will recognize it. So first, small things happen in your world, and they happen to trigger that whole part of the pattern, okay? The thing that says, I'm not good enough. Well, then, you know, something happens in your world, and it points it out to you, and you actually have the experience of not being good enough. Great. Now you have an opportunity to really go in and look at it and come to terms with it and neutralize it and, you know, release the energy that's trapped there. Well, most people, instead of taking that opportunity, continue to run from it. So they'll make excuses for why whatever happened. They'll blame someone else for it, or they'll blame the weather or, you know, a situation, and they refuse to really bring it back to themselves. And in doing so, they keep it locked in this unconscious level. Well, the universe is only going to bring it to you on a small scale a certain number of times. And each time you have the opportunity to cancel out the charge, okay? At some point, when you continue to refuse to do it, the universe has to bring it to you in a way that you cannot deny. You will have to, as we would say, you will have to live it out in the physical. So that always means something ends up happening in your world that you would deem bad, right? Because everybody thinks in those terms. If they lose a job, they think it's bad. If they have a car accident, they think it's bad. You know, they have a spouse who leaves them, it's bad, right? Well, from a personal place, it's experienced that way because, again, the personal self doesn't want to take responsibility for its end of that whole highly polarized situation. However, from the viewpoint of one who can see beyond it, all of those quote-unquote bad situations are an amazing blessing, because within each one of them is given the lesson that has to be seen through. Right? The lesson that has to be, it's not a learning, it's a remembering, okay? And you have the opportunity whenever it comes to do that. Now, you can do that as far as just doing your inner work, right? Meaning you go in and you go in looking for it. You're not waiting for something to happen in the outside world. You actually go in looking for it. And when that kind of work is done, then students who function in that way find that their outside world doesn't, you know, they don't have these huge incidents that take place in their outside world, because it's not necessary. If you balance it on the inside, why does it have to be seriously unbalanced on the outside? See, it's all about balance. And your inner world and your outer world are the same thing. If you keep running, it has to be bigger, right? So now it's big, and now you have the opportunity to take advantage of the situation and really do the work around it to release the charge, release all of those negative states of mind that are locked in place concerning shame, especially. That's the biggie. And then at that point, you know, it can be over with and then you'll never have to walk that path again. Well, the interesting thing is that coming into 2015, this is going to be a big year for those lessons. And I really am not saying that from an alarmist place, but from a personal place as well as the collective place, we are going to begin really witnessing people having to live their stuff out in the physical in 2015. There's no question. It's time. And I was saying to the group earlier, you can see it if you pull back and look from a collective level just at what's going on in the planet. There's so much stuff that's kind of right at that boiling point, you know, right at that tipping point. And the question is, what's the collective going to do with it? Because what we're witnessing is the collective level. Remember, wasn't it last week or the week before we talked about the inner and the outer world and the collective? I was talking about Hitler and stuff. Was that last week? Yeah. Okay. So this is in line with that same thing, that what we're seeing is that the collective as a whole is holding, there's a lot of charge around certain things that the collective is holding. Some of it's conscious and some of it's not. And it's our opportunity now to wake up to the things that are being held on an unconscious level collectively. Now we can do that and wake up in a way that it doesn't have to mean we end up going, you know, seeing wars. We don't have to see ecological collapse. We don't have to see, you know, full-blown banking collapse. It's not necessary. It's just a matter of seeing the things collectively that we have really been in denial over and that we have really been repressing. And when that's seen, it's not necessary. But I don't know, I can't speak for the collective today and know how it's going to play itself out in the coming year. So the most important thing to keep in mind is that you have an enormous impact on the collective because you are part of the collective. And what I always tell my students is when you reach the space where you can really reside in the objective observer, you know, the personal self is an observer on the level of it being personal. And so the interpreter there is a very personal interpreter. And when you move into the space of the objective observer, the interpretation that's done is on an objective level. So it doesn't have an attachment to the personal story of me. And from that place, it can actually, it's in a much better space to take right action. Now, it's not taking right action from its knowing, but it's taking right action from objectively seeing all the things that are going on and interpreting it from that place, which is a beautiful thing. Beyond that, you'll move into the state of your actual knowing with a capital K, where right action is just natural because you just have the knowing of what is right in any moment. And that's the divine you. So, you know, collectively, what you can do is you can do your work. And as you do your work and you're able to pull out of the attachment of the personal self, then you actually are removing that level of your own energetic charge to the unconscious collective. You're removing it, right? So every time someone does that little bit of work and it removes that little bit of attachment to that thought form that's collective, it makes it that much easier for the next person to do the same, and then for the next person to do the same. And it snowballs very quickly, actually. So as I was telling the group earlier, reminding them that, you know, we don't have to have 50.1% of the people get it in order for everybody to get it. It's not even close to 50% that's necessary. It's a very small percentage, actually, that will tip the balance. So the best thing you can do for everybody is to do your own work. You know, as I think it was Tim, I think you came up with the example of the woman with a kid in the airplane. So if the airplane's going down and the oxygen masks fall, they always say, you know, take care of yourself first before you attempt to help somebody else. Well, this isn't any different. This is the exact same thing, because you truly can't help someone else until you have helped yourself. All right. Because once your work is done, now you can be of service in the world. What you have to keep in mind is that the personal self, all right, fallen consciousness, that patterned consciousness, only functions from three things. And it, you know, I sound like a broken record because I say it all the time, but it's domination, manipulation, and control. The personal self is not capable. Now hear me, this is a big deal. It is not capable of functioning outside of domination, manipulation, and control, regardless of what it looks like. Okay? You may look like the most loving person in the world, but if that is not coming from the heart, if it's coming from the lower self, that whole loving facade thing is happening because you're trying to manipulate others, or you're trying to be in control over others, and you're using the loving mask as a way to get there. Okay? That's all the personal self knows to do. It's very fearful, and everything is about, you know, oh, how do I get mine, and how do I protect mine, and, you know, it doesn't really care about anything else other than making sure that I'm taken care of, because its whole experience is that it's been abandoned and nobody is there to take care of it, so I have to take care of myself, and that's where it functions from. So everyone on the planet, you know, kind of is living from that, unless they're truly illumined. But those beings are very few and far between. So you have to, you know, as students of deeper work, it's part of your work to move in the world always looking for that. You know, as you interact with people, you stop seeing them as individual people and you start seeing them as the program. You know, and how is the, what's the program after now? And it gets to a point where you can't not see it. You know, you can't not see it. I drive my son crazy with that, by the way. I drive him absolutely crazy because I can't not see the manipulation. Yeah. And I call him on it every day, you know, and he hates me for it because I'm constantly throwing it right back in his face. I see what you're doing. He's like, I'm not doing anything. I'm like, oh, I beg to differ. I see what you're doing, you know. And the thing is that in that moment, like, I'm not having this interchange with my son in the truest sense. I'm having the interchange. Think of it this way. It's, you know, it's like higher mind is having this interchange with lower mind. That's all that's going on there, right? Truth is confronting illusion and saying, I see you. I see you. And you're not going to get away with it, right? And, of course, the voice of the illusion wants to fight that. It's not comfortable with that at all. So it comes across as now a 14-year-old boy who's had his feelings hurt and storms off and does whatever, right? Well, the thing is that as you move deeper and deeper into your work, it's so impersonal. There's no one there to feel bad when the 14-year-old storms off, right? There's no mom sitting there feeling guilty about what just happened or feeling sorry for him because he's been victimized. There's no mom there that goes, oh, I was just really terrible and horrendous to me. Like that. It's just gone. It's just gone. Right? Because you're standing in a different place. And that's the strength of the Christ. I mean, that's strength. You know, and it's funny because I think people get a little confused about the whole, especially in like the New Age community where everything is love and light, which I love to tease people about. But it's a little confusing because if you look at even one of the most famous statues of Archangel Michael has him brandishing his sword and he's picking up Satan's head and he's about to, you know, take his head off, right? Well, does that look like a loving thing to do? No, not especially. You know, but Michael he's fierce. He's fierce. And with good reason. See, when Jesus, you know, stormed the temple and knocked over all those tables with the money changers, he was fierce. Right? Because that's what was needed to make a point. And that space isn't worried about how people are going to perceive it. It doesn't go, ooh, I should be careful how I do that. You know, no, no. Because what it's up against is pure illusion, right? It's the money changers in this particular example, you know, they have completely lost sight of who they are. They're believing in this whole thing that they're caught up in. You know, we could say the same thing about the banking system today, couldn't we? The people behind the corporate banking systems of the world, we could say the same thing. They're so caught up in it. They believe it. They believe it's necessary. They believe in all of this, you know, craziness. Like, I mean, just at the very core that we even need money. It's insane. But it's a very, very real thing for them, you know. So what is needed? Well, not that we kind of tiptoe around them when we're going to hurt their feelings. They got to wake up, you know. And how do you wake people up? Well, sometimes it's with a 2x4 to the head, right? Realistically, I mean, let's face it. There are those who wake up very quickly and they are self-motivated to do so. And there are those who will drag their feet and they will fight it every single step of the way. And what's the Christ going to do? Well, what's the important thing? What is the important thing? The important thing is that they wake up. Because could there be, you know, anything worse than completely forgetting your own divinity? I mean, let's face it. You think losing a job is bad? You forgot your God. You forgot your God. You forgot you've got wings and you have no idea how to use them anymore. So from the perspective of the Christ, what more important thing could there be than to wake people up? You know, who cares what they think about you right now? At the end of the day, when they're on the other side of it, they're going to be like, oh, thank you. Oh my gosh, I never would have seen that. Thank you so much. You know, they'll be indebted to you forever. And anyone who has worked with a personal guide feels exactly like that. And for good reason. It's because we can't do it on our own. We need someone to guide us. Someone who has walked the path, right? That was the beauty of the Buddha, the beauty of the Christ. They walked the path. And then they were there to guide others. They weren't there to be idolized or worshipped. Not at all. That wasn't the point. The point is to become the work, right? To become that thing that you seek. You know, and not even to become it, but to remember you are it, because you always have been it. But along the way, that understanding and that actualization got lost. And that's the only thing that matters. So on the flip side of what's coming this year, we're also going to see the opposite happening. We're going to see people who really have invested themselves in their spiritual paths finally starting to move into the space where they really are on the receiving end of the beauty of life, the magic of life. You know, some people on the planet who have been in service for years have struggled and struggled for years and never gave up. And that will be rewarded. You know, it takes a really strong commitment to do something that you believe in that the world doesn't understand and to continue to do it even when everything in the world tells you you shouldn't. Right? And there are a lot of people on the planet who are absolutely in that boat. They have just been struggling and struggling and struggling, just barely eking by, you know, and still doing their work. And I really believe that this is the tipping point we're finally going to see, because now they are functioning from that level of the unified field, right? Or extremely close to it. And from that space, now they will have the opportunity to actually watch a blossoming take place in their realities. Meaning for organizations, you know, such as our own. And I would include us in this, absolutely. that organizations who have, you know, their volunteer run and a small group of people who, you know, give everything they've got to show up and to be there, to be of service to others. It's time for these groups to really see the blossoming take place, where people will truly begin to recognize the value of what it is that we bring, you know, not just on a personal level, but on a collective level, because that's what really matters. You know, it's one thing to say, yeah, I'll come and donate money to the organization because I got something personal out of what you're doing. It's another whole level when you recognize the value that the people who are of service are, you know, putting into the collective. You know, I mean, there are lots of people out there doing work that I wouldn't have personal experience with, but boy, do I value what they do. You know, and there are people out there, you have no idea, they are working so hard for the collective and for humanity, and they don't even talk about it. You know, they're completely under the radar, and you wouldn't have any idea. You know, it's beautiful. There's so much humility out there, and it's so beautiful. So, you know, so the question is for the coming year, kicking off with the solstice on Sunday, and then really beginning to ramp up after New Year's, you know, where are you going to be? What path are you going to walk down in the next year? It's something to really begin to think about. You know, set your intentions on Sunday with that new moon of where you want to be at the end of 2015. Not only from a place of wishing about where you're going to be, but setting the intention that you are going to commit to whatever is, you know, required of you in order to get there. I mean, what's the point of sitting down and writing out all the things that you want to have happen if you aren't committed to doing the work, right? It's kind of pointless. And that's the bottom line, is that, you know, you're here experiencing polarized consciousness because it's time for you to master it. And it's one heck of a tough thing to master, right? That's why people have been recycling for millions of years, some longer. It's a tough thing to master, but that's what you're here to do. And your mastery here will catapult you in the illumined worlds into a space where you can take on, you know, opportunities for expansion in ways you can't even fathom. I mean, you can't even fathom it. Some of you are in training to be a planet. You know? I mean, then that's not a joke. Terra, Earth, I call her Terra, some people say Gaia, is a consciousness just like you. A very, very evolved one. Very evolved. Because, you know, she's holding everything in her, all the elementals, right? Human consciousness, all of it is being held within her. Right? Wow, you talk about love. It's amazing. And then go out from there and look at, you know, our sun, Helios and Vesta. They're holding the whole solar system. All of the extremely expanded consciousnesses of all the planets and everything and being on them. You know, and don't stop yourself at the level of physicality, because remember, this is just the kind of the lowest outpicturing dimensionally of this planet. And there are multiple dimensions of this planet that are all overlaid one on the other, right? So Helios and Vesta holds all of it for all of the planets. Some of you are in training to at one point be a sun. Now that, for a lot of people, sounds a little too woo-woo. I assure you, it's not. It is not. You already are a sun in your own way, yeah? As the aspect of God that you already are a blazing sun, right? Just not as expanded as a planet or a physical sun like we experience here. So in order to get there, we got to master this first. And it doesn't, we don't master it by wanting to run away from it. We master it by tackling it head on. Right? You know, it's not any different than your parents teach you growing up. If you have an issue, you have to tackle it head on. Can't run away from stuff, right? And everyone's taught that. How many people actually listen? I don't know. Probably not too many. And then, of course, for even the people who teach you, you have to tackle your stuff head on. Most of them aren't actually doing the same thing. So it's easier to teach someone else to do what you won't do yourself, right? But it is absolutely necessary. Because you have to master here. When you've mastered here, you will ascend out of it when the time is right for you. You could be a master here in form. Doesn't mean that the moment you reach mastery, you disappear. You have work to do until you don't, right? And then at that point, you don't have to come back here. Now, if you choose to, that's choice. Or you choose to stay kind of locked into this fallen system until, like Archangel Michael, you know, he's there until the last soul is God-free again. And then he'll fold up his wings and be done with it, right? Move on. It's a blink of an eye from that perspective, right? I mean, we think of it as, oh my gosh, like, wow, what an amazing commitment. Well, and it is. So don't get me wrong. It absolutely is. But from that perspective, time doesn't exist. So, you know, and it's an act of service that is given willingly and with great love. So, and some of you would do the same. So even ascending out, you would decide to stay, you know, to help in other ways, right? Maybe some of you will end up being an ascended master that other people pray to, you know, who's to say? Who's to say, right? So this is the time for you to really start focusing on this. This world here is not real. Your life here is not your life as you have known it. It never has been. You have been in a space where you've believed a lot of things to be true that aren't. And a lot of humanity is waking up to that on a collective level. You know, baby steps, they're starting to wake up to the fact that, you know, there are kind of people behind the scenes running the show. That's a level of awakening. It still keeps people very stuck in a polarized way of viewing the world, but it is a level of awakening that's necessary, right? And we're seeing that. That's good. It's very good. Things that were, you know, taboo to talk about 10 years ago now are commonplace, you know, talking about, you know, just like a lot of what people term as conspiracy theory stuff. 10 years ago, if you talked about, let's say 9/11 being an inside job. I mean, you didn't talk about that because, oh my gosh, you know, now you see, I've seen stickers slapped on guardrails, like off the highway and like all that kind of stuff. I'm like, it's out there, you know, it's out there. Now what you believe about it is up to you. That's fine. But the point is that this kind of stuff is really making it into mainstream. It's beautiful. It needs to happen because mainstream has got to be able to see both sides of everything rather than pushing one side away. And especially, we'll use 9/11. It's a good example. You have Americans who would say, oh my gosh, like, we would never do that. We're America. You know, that whole sense of pride thing, the whole America number one thing. And we say, we don't torture people, or we would never do that. And, you know, you're unpatriotic if you believe that that's true. That's denial. It's denial. You know, I had a very dear friend who fought in the Vietnam War. I think he did six. He was actually trying to die over there. He did like six rounds over there. You know, he could have gone home, but he didn't. And the stories he told me were just horrendous. And he said, you know, the thing is, people believe that as Americans, you know, we don't do these things at war. And he said they have no idea. They have no idea what's happening, you know. But they believe what they hear. They believe that, you know, we're America, so we go in and we're the good guys and we're there to free people and all this stuff. And the bottom line is that, you know, hospitals are blown up and churches are blown up and women and children are killed non-discriminately. And it happens all the time because that's their job, right? And that's the reality of it. And people have to wake up to the reality of what is playing out here. You know, it is an illusion, but until you get to the space where you can actually see what's happening, you'll never be ready to take the next step into seeing beyond that, right? That's ultimately where everybody's headed, right? And the point is, you're going to get there one way or another. You're going to swim to the shore, or you're going to be pulled to the shore. You know, the question is, which way do you want to go? It's your choice. Now, you do have free will here. It's your choice. And you can choose it for yourself, right? So it's time to get real. Get really real in the next week. Take a good look at where you've been the last 5 years and what you did this year and all the things that you said you want to do that you haven't done and all the things you've done that you swore you'd never do and all of it. Just take stock, you know, and then make that decision for yourself. You know, you really want to move forward. Well, okay, so if you want to move forward, it's time to function from a really clear place. And the time to do it is now. There's, you know, as I said, I was saying earlier that people still don't believe the ascension's actually happening. They still think of it as something that's out there, down the road. 2012, it didn't seem to happen. So now some people are saying 2017. You got some people saying like 2021, like whatever. And that's all that's going to happen. They're just going to keep kicking it out. And never do they see that they're walking it right now. You know, you are walking the ascension path right now. And all of humanity is walking it every day right now. The vibration on this planet is not what it was a year ago. If the whole of humanity could be dropped into where we were 365 days ago energetically, it would feel a heck of a shock. It would feel like it got punched in the face. Collectively, because it would experience a huge drop in energy, right? You can't see it. You walk it every day, so you aren't recognizing that it's happening. It's kind of like you start losing weight. It takes a good while before you actually recognize that you're losing weight. And then one day it's kind of like, oh, my clothes feel different, you know? This is the same thing. Or if you haven't exercised for a long time, it takes a while before you really feel like, wow, it really is making an impact. I feel so much better. You know, you just don't see it because it's something you're accustomed to every day, right? But if you were losing weight and you hadn't seen someone in like 2 months and they came in and saw you, they'd be like, oh my gosh, you look fantastic. Are you losing weight? And you'd be like, you know, I don't even know. So this is the same thing. You are living your ascension path right now, you know, and you're walking it every day. So you can't tell the difference between yesterday and today as far as where your vibration is sitting. It's very subtle. You'd have to be extremely tuned in to actually feel that one. Really subtle. But if you look back, and I have my students do this sometimes, I'll be like, look back at where you were a year ago. Go back to your writing. This is why journaling is so beautiful. Of course, the processing work is all written work. Like, go back and look at what you were writing about a year ago. You know, see where you sit now when you go back and read that, you know, and for all of my students, they'd be like, oh my gosh, like, I don't even associate with that person anymore. Who was that person who wrote that? You know, it's beautiful. And I wish the same for you, you know. I hope that you can look back and recognize the advances that you have made in your level of compassion, right? Your level of service. However you give service, it's all equal. And I hope for all of you that you can see that your level of love has also been growing and growing so that you can use that as your barometer and know that it will just continue to grow moving forward. And it won't be long and you'll be seeing all this from the other side and you're going to look back on all of it and laugh. There's going to be a big party on the other side when it's all said and done. We did it, right? We always knew we would. You're already victorious. Remember, you came back in time to do this. It's already done. There's no potential for losing here. It's already done. You're doomed to success. Right? All right. Very good. So we won't be with you live next week or the following because of the holidays. So it's a little premature, but if you were with me last year at our show around Christmas, you will recognize this music. I played it last year too. It's one of my absolute favorite songs this time of the year. And the energy behind it is just fantastic. So what a great way for us to, as a group, kind of end our calendar year here. And we actually just had our 1 year anniversary for the show back in November. Yeah. So yay for us. And thank you so much for continuing to tune in to us. And we love to have you listening and always love to hear from you. If you want to email us, you can email us at shusara@theshambhalacenter.org. And we can answer questions or bring questions up on the air. If you want an answer on the air, we can do that too. So have a beautiful, beautiful Christmas. If you celebrate Christmas, enjoy the holidays and a fantastic new year. And again, theshambhalacenter.org, go to the media link. And if you want to meditate with us on Sunday, we will be in meditation from 12 to 2. Love you so very much. You have a fantastic night. Good night. You are divine.